everyone. My name is Dmitry Kurbatov. I'm from Russia, and I'm a kind of security researcher for telecommunication infrastructure. And here today, I would like to present to you some, maybe not new, but the information about signaling networks, the SS7, which stands for signaling system number 7. And I hope this will give you some kind of new vision of insecurities in mobile world. But first of all, I'd like to make a greeting to you because just a few weeks ago, I read this article on the GSMA website, which stands for right now in Korea, you have fully integrated voice over LTE services. So all of your free network operators right now are interconnected and you can use Volta with a super quality of voice. This is really great because you are the only country in the world that can at the moment afford this stuff. So this is the picture of already implemented LTE networks in the world. But as you can see, there are pretty many places and countries in the world that have this technology. But unfortunately, back in Russia and also in most of the European countries, we just use LTE technology like a broadband access to the internet. We cannot perform voice calls over this brand new technology. And there are not so many places on the earth that can actually offer services like voice over LTE to their customers. Only in the United States, somewhere in the Norway, Korea, probably in Japan, maybe some places in Germany, I'm not sure, but there are not so many places as you can see. I hope this LTEmap.org not lies to me. So this is it, the situation. The situation is a bit different in the rest countries because still, for example, if I'm in France or maybe in Russia and my phone phone is actually using LTE for data and for surfing web, I still have to perform the procedure called handover. Not the handover, but the handover, if I try to perform a phone call or maybe send a short message. And this procedure, God bless, it is some kind of seamless procedure for subscribers, but still, when I try to perform a phone call, I have to downgrade to 3G or 2G communication and use this kind of old and ancient technologies. And this is the kind of problem because this during this time, the subscriber is always sleeping between LTE, 3G, and 2G, depending on what's the reason of usage of this phone at the moment, whether you want to surf web or perform phone calls and type a short messages. So, right now, as I already said, in Korea, you have interconnected voice over LTE. And what this means for you? This means that actually all three of your networks right now have interconnected their networks. So, subscribers that actually belong to different mobile operators right now use voice over LTE just fine. So, all the traffic goes through the brand new network. And for this reason, all of the mobile operators use some kind of interconnect networks and different roaming networks. I'll try to make my presentation pretty simplified in a technical point of view, so it will be easier for you to understand. And please excuse me if some telco guys right here on the place, because it will be not maybe 100% correct. So this is the types of interconnect and roaming networks. There are three main types of these. The first one is SS7, very ancient technology, signaling system. The second one is GRX, which stands for GPRS roaming exchange. Usually network operators use it for while you, for example, in roaming and still want to use data roaming. I know it is still very expensive, but they use a separate network, just like a small internet. It is called GRX. And we also have in place the IPX network. This is the IP exchange network, which is used only for 4G network operators. And right now, for example, in Korea, let's make an example. If two mobile subscribers belong to different network operators and your voice over LTE call goes right through the IPX, let's imagine the things happen in this way. But still, there are so many places on the earth which actually operate on the GSM standard. And there are so many places where UMTS and WCDMA 3G technologies are still in place. So in case you want to communicate with these guys, you still will use SS7 network for call setup, for short messages, and all that stuff, like billing and etc. So the rest of the world are kind of slowpox, really, because we still use 2G and 3G instead of LTE. LTE is used only as a broadband access to the internet. And this is a kind of problem for LTE mobile operators, because you still need to support some kind of backward compatibility, because you cannot just forget about the rest of the world. There are parts of, you know, the kind of civilized islands that use 4G, but still, GSM covers, I guess, 80% of the world. So this is still most used technology at the moment. And this is some kind of IPv6 versus IPv4 dilemma, because those islands of civilization still have to use some ancient technology to communicate with the rest of the world. You cannot just throw back the old technologies, you still have to use them to interconnect with the rest of the guys around the globe. This is pretty much like this. And just because of this, SS7 is still most used in the world interconnect and roaming network. This means that I'll give you just a brief introduction of what SS7 actually is. It was first introduced maybe in the 80s, and it was used for fixed telephony communication. It is used for call setup, for billing purposes, and etc. Right now, in mobile networks of first generation, second, and the third generation as well, it is used as this kind of network that gives the intelligent services for mobile operators to provide mobility services, all the stuff related to call control, all the billing purposes, and as well as exchange of some cryptography information. Because when you go from the carrier to some roaming network, to roaming partner, your encryption keys for your handset to be able to communicate securely with the base station actually exchange over the SS7 network, as well as short messages travel just across the SS7 network. For you to understand it briefly, SS7 is a signaling network, so it doesn't used exactly for call communication, just for call setup. And no traffic goes over it. Only call setup procedures and some and short messages, for example. So, as I already told you, this is a very ancient technology, and it used to be very widely deployed. And right now, unfortunately, as it usually happens, technologies for communications are not built with security in mind. It is only for communication purposes. So right now, for telco guys, SS7 is a kind of security issue, and there are a huge amount of concerns about it, because there are not much ways to make this network more secure. But for the last 10 years, nobody actually cared about this theme. SS7 was something you just have to live with. But during 2014, there were a huge amount of security reports and very interesting speeches on different security conferences. And security researchers started to begin a deep dive into this topic. For example, this is mostly because the publicity, because during 2013, I guess also, the Washington Post newspaper published a very interesting report about the possibility of secret user tracking for the surveillance purposes. And this is why actually this theme somehow, why SS7 is a buzzword at the moment. So, SS7 offers a huge amount of features for communication, as well as huge amounts of possibilities for an attacker. And unfortunately, the possibility of tracking of mobile user is not the only one. In mobile world, it just called just a usual feature, but SS7 also can help an attacker to withdraw money from your account. It can help attacker to intercept calls and short messages, as well as perform denial of service on exact subscriber, on the victim, or on the whole network running under the single mobile switching center. Let's see, this is probably the main threats that can bring SS7 to you, because there are three main types of threats. The first subset of threats are for the mobile subscribers, because all of you are mobile subscribers, just as me. The second type of threats are threats that actually to the threats mobile operator, because there are a huge amount of possibilities to perform denial of service attacks on different nodes in the signaling network, making the network not able to provide services. And one more topic is the threats to the Internet of Things and all the technologies that use mobile networks only as a transport, but still use it. Very good. So today our topics will be about the tracking. So it is location of mobile phones. The second part will be about the denial of services, how it is possible actually to perform denial of service on exact user, knowing only his phone number. And the last part will be about the interception. Today I'll talk not about the interception of phone calls, because this is a kind of very hard to explain. It will take me too much time. So I'll show you the way to intercept short messages. All right, so what about tracking? Probably the surveillance is a huge problem, because the first thing you would like to know about some guy who is under control is his whereabouts, how much time he spends in any location. And this is the thing that usually intelligence services uses. But with the usage of features available on the signaling networks, any bad guy can do exactly the same thing. And when I'm saying bad guy, it doesn't mean actually that the bad guy is some kind of hacker. Bad guys could be also the surveillance service of another country. So let's see how it is made possible. You know, in signaling networks, almost all attacks start with the first phase. We call it step O, because this is almost the same for all type of attacks. So our victim will be Bob. The green one area, the green cloud, is Bob's home network. And attacker, the bad guy, located somewhere on the international SS7 network. So he's probably operating from the some roaming partner side. On the first step, the attacker tries to collect as much information about the home network as it possible. So he just sent a special MAP message called SRI4SM. You know, in SS7, all the messages have very telling names. So SRI4SM actually stands for Send Routing Information for Short Message. At this moment, attacker represents himself as just a node, which is, for example, a short message service center. And at this moment, attacker tries to make the home network believe that he has a short message that should be delivered to Bob. So he's asking some additional information about Bob's location. There are absolutely no ways in the signal networks to somehow authenticate the source of the message. This is why the HLR, the home location register, is a database where is all the information about whole subscribers is stored. For HLR, there is absolutely no way to check whether attacker is a legitimate SMS sender or not. So he will probably reply for the SRI4SM message with the following information. HLR will disclose its own address called global title. This is the addressing scheme used in the SS7. He will also send the information about mobile switching center, which is currently serving Bob, who is the victim. And he will also reply with the IMSI identifier. You know, in mobile networks, nobody actually cares about your phone numbers, because when network operators communicate with each other, the only identifier they need for subscriber is the IMSI identifier. So when the attacker already knows the address of mobile switching center, which is currently serving Bob, he will try to perform the direct access to him. He'll send one more MAP message. MAP just a protocol, don't care about it at the moment. He will send a message called provide subscriber information, very telling name as well. This message usually used to get some additional information whether Bob is actually available, if he is in the network right now. What's his location? This information usually used for billing purposes and to find out whether it is possible or not to send short message to the Bob right now. Or maybe he is somewhere not available in the network. So the MSC, Mobile Switching Center, if Bob is under his control at the moment and is available, will reply to the attacker with information which will include the cell identifier. The cell identifier is the unique identifier of any, let's call it base station. So base station is kind of antenna that is used to communicate with the radio network. And using these identifiers, the mobile country code, mobile network code, LEC identifier and cell ID, there are, if you have never tried it, you should Google it, because there are so many services on the internet that can just give you a point on the map if you provide them with these identifiers of cell ID. So the attacker should actually just put this information to the NICE web interface and get exact point on the map, on the Google map, for example, given the exact location. Of course, this would not be the exact location of the victim, but it would be the geographical location of the base station that is currently nearby Bob. So you see, this is very, very, very simple attack, and any script kiddie can actually do a Python script that will interrogate with signaling network, for example, any 20 minutes, then we'll perform this kind of checkup with a cell ID, get the point on the map, and in this way, you get the surveillance. Bob is totally under control because you get the route of the Bob's locations. You can track him 24 hours a day. And you can also collect information where Bob right now, for how long he stays at home, at work, anywhere, in the bar. And you for sure will know where Bob actually not present at the moment, for example, for robbery purposes or so on. And of course, this is a very nice info, because it would be very strange if no one will try to commercialize it. And also, I guess the Washington Post, maybe in 2011, published an article about the Verint company. Verint is a, I guess, US-based company, which has a product for surveillance called Skylock. It has a very nice graphical user interface. You should just put the MSISDN, which is actually MSISDN is a so-called the phone number. You just put the phone number of the victim to this interface, and this is it. Some additional configuration, some settings, and you can track the subscriber anywhere in the earth. And what the problem is that actually in the SS7 world, there are no borders. It's just like the internet, but without firewalls and IPS systems, because no one actually cares about some firewalling device on the border of their networks. So using this software, any surveillance service, any surveillance service or agency can actually track mobile subscribers that at the moment located in the other city, in other country. So this is kind of violation of privacy, I guess. And this company, I'm not sure, but they state that they sell these services only to government, to military guys. I hope so. But still, these military and government guys should use it only with the prescription of the court, I guess. If not, this is the violation of privacy and protection of personal data, because no one wants to be constantly monitored. So, for mobile operators, this is not very good news, because, you know, this is some kind of feature in SS7 which cannot be stopped that easily, because there are huge amount of ways. I showed you only one type of attack for secret tracking, but there are huge amount of different signaling messages that can be used for exactly the same purpose. God bless that some network operators trying to do some things to stop the possibility of tracking of their subscribers from the abroad. So let's go to the next topic, I guess. The denial of service. Let's see. So Bob is totally under control. We know where he and how much time he spends in each location. Probably one more nice feature is that you can make Bob unavailable for all incoming communications. Usually, military guys use some kind of jammers for this purpose. But the problem with jammers is that you have a huge backpack with antennas, and you need a power supply for this, and you need to get really close to the victim to make him unavailable on the network. And it is not targeted, because when you turn on your jammer, mobile network will just disappear for all people around it. But there are ways to do it in a targeted way, just for Bob, for example. So this is exactly the same step like we performed on the first case. But the difference is that this time, attacker, the bad guy, would be representing himself not as a SMS center, but as the mobile switching service, mobile switch center. So, one more time, he will try to get as much information about the home network and the whereabouts of our victim, Bob. But this time, attacker doesn't actually care about the MSC currently serving Bob. He just wants to get the IMSI identifier. Just after he received this information, he will do another request to the HLR as well, and he will represent himself as a MSC somewhere in the roaming network, somewhere abroad, and he will try to make home network believe that Bob actually, in a matter of seconds, moved to another country, and right now is currently served by some another MSC, the fake MSC. As I told you before, there are no ways for authentication and authorization of the source of these messages in SS7, so there is no way for HLR to check whether it is a fake MSC or not. Probably most of the mobile operators have roaming agreement between themselves, so almost the routing will do it purpose. HLR just believes the fake MSC that Bob moved to another country. And of course HLR will try to release some memory on the current MSC, so HLR do it best for the home network to believe that Bob is not actually right now in the coverage area of this exact network. Bob has moved. So now, when, for example, Alex, Bob's friend, want to maybe perform a phone call to Bob, this phone call received on the MSC of the home network, and MSC will ask HLR about Bob's whereabouts, because MSC doesn't know where currently located Bob. Come on, this is mobile communication. Bob can go anywhere he wants. So the MSC will ask the HLR about Bob's whereabouts. And since HLR actually thinks that Bob already moved to another country, HLR will try to communicate with the latest MSC in his memory. So he'll try to communicate with the fake MSC, with attacker actually. And at this moment, if an attacker doesn't want Alex to be able to communicate to Bob, he will just not respond to this HLR request. And at this moment, Bob is actually unavailable for incoming phone calls and short messages. This is that simple, and I'll show you the demo of it. Just a second. This is it. So the big one, the big handset will be the Alex, and the small one will be the Bob. So we just try to perform a phone call just to make sure that they can actually communicate at the moment. Yeah, you see the phone call is received. So we will drop it off because we are not interested in speaking to Alex right now. And now we'll see how the attack actually is performed. So on the left part of the screen, this is our tool we use for constructing SS7 messages. I have blurred some information, some sensitive information on it. And we just sent to the network the series of messages, we will perform the so-called update location request. So on the Wireshark screen, I'm not sure the quality is that good, but you can see that we are trying to make home network believe that we are serving BOP at the moment. So, as you can see, there are not so many messages needed to make the home network believe that BOP actually moved. So the update location procedure was performed, and now we try to make a phone call one more time. So Alex trying to call BOP, and at this moment on the Wireshark screen we can see new messages coming in. This is the home HLR trying to communicate with the fake MSC. And we can see that nothing actually happens because BOP cannot receive the phone call. And the home network still try to get his location, his roaming number and all that stuff. It will try for maybe 30 seconds or so because this is voice calls. Yeah, it takes a while and still nothing happens. During this time, this is just maybe 30-second timeout should pass for the home network start belief. Yeah, the call has ended, and right now home network thinks that BOP is not available actually. So as you can see, right now someone is really obsessed with BOP. He performed his total surveillance over his tracking, over his geolocation. Can make him unavailable for incoming phone calls and short messages. But let's see, are there any ways to get his information, to get BOP's short messages, for example? There are a few ways, actually, to get short messages. Probably all of you know that if there are some malware installed on the smartphone, yeah, you can get the short messages if there is a malware installed already. But if it is a targeted attack, sometimes it will be very, very hard to infect the exact phone. So, okay, this is not our case. The second way is to reissue the SIM card. Probably in some countries, maybe in third world, as well as in Russia, it is possible to reissue the SIM card, maybe clone it. But you should understand this is a one-time attack. It will work only once. Another interesting thing is to collect the information on the radio interface. This is exactly the thing which Carsten Knoll does. But this is all about the cracking the encryption algorithm of the GSM standard. For example, right here in Korea, it just wouldn't work because right now you are using LTE. Okay, for the first, how it works back in Russia, for example, if someone using LTE, I just turn on the jammer and on the exact channel, and the LTE network is not available anymore. So the handset have to downgrade to the 3G communication. Then I turn on another jammer and make the 3G network not available as well. And then handset have to move to the 2G communication and finally use GSM. And of course, GSM is crackable. It uses a 5-1 encryption algorithms. So it is possible to perform back in Russia and maybe in Europe. But here in Korea, as I know, you do not have GSM network anymore. You only use 3G and LTE. So at the moment, 3G encryption algorithms are not crackable, as I know. So this way, just this method just wouldn't work very fine. But there is a way to intercept short messages using the SS7 network, and it is very hard to not to make it possible. Let's see how it is done. So the common step, exactly the same. I hope by now you already have some kind of deja vu feeling, because if not, you were not actually listening to me, because this is exactly the same I did already two times before. Okay, the attacker one more time represents himself as a mobile switching center and trying to get information about BOP's whereabouts and collect his IMSI identifier. HLR believes that he is the new MSC and wants to serve BOP in the roaming network, so he will just reply to him. Then the attacker will try to make home network believe that BOP actually moved, this is fine for the HLR. So okay, the update location procedure went just fine. So Bob right now in the roaming. And yeah, we make the procedure to release some memory on the previous MSC. So when next time when someone tries to send a short message to Bob, the short message will be proceeded on the MSC first, on the mobile switching center. Then it would be translated to the short message service center in the home network. But since SMSC does not know nothing about the current location of the Bob, he just have to ask the home location register about his whereabouts. And of course, HLR will reply with the MSC, with the address of the fake MSC. So this SMS goes just fine to the attacker, right to the attacker. This is also very, very simple attack. I'll show you it on the video. Okay, so just for a test purpose, I'll send from Alex to Bob a short message. We'll wait for it. Okay, so it is received on the Bob's phone. Now we perform the update location procedure for the Bob, making home network believe that Bob actually moved. Okay, the update location is finished, and we try to send one more short message. I'm not sure if you see it, but the content of short message, it is actually a question how secure are one-time passwords sent over short messages. So we try to send it to Bob, and we see that nothing actually happens on his phone, but the attacker received some messages. We'll see what's the payload of these messages. We'll see. And here is it. You see, this is the original short message. As you can see, this is translated in a plain text. There are no encryption of short messages. And you can see this is very, very easy to get the information instead of victim. So now probably you should know the answer, that one-time passwords that are sent over short messages are no good, actually. They are not very good secured. So who actually cares? Well, actually I do, because the interception of short messages in this exact way is exactly the thing that bad guys needed, because there are so many services that treat short messages as a very secure communication channel. You can perform a password recovery for Gmail account, for the Facebook, for any social network using short messages. And in some countries, we also have the payment services. And the only identifier for this payment service is actually your mobile phone number. So as you can understand, it is pretty clear that if the only identifier of the user of this payment service is his phone number, the recovery of the password will be exactly over the SMS. So this is very easy to withdraw some money from someone. And now the question how to get to ETC7, because this is usually the question. Well, my colleagues and I, we know three main ways to get to this network. The first one is the boring one, the legal way, to get the license of mobile operator or just to get a license of telephony operator or to perform some services to this operator. This is our way. We are just contractors or subcontractors because we offer some services for mobile operators. But another way is to find a guy who actually works in a telco operator, because I guess you know, there are huge amount of technicians and support staff that works for telco, as well as subcontractors and probably some outsourced stuff. And if you try to Google a bit, or maybe using Tor, try to search in a deep web, you can find this type of advertisements that people are actually looking to get access to the SS7. Some of them are looking to get this kind of not very serious access, just to perform HLR lookup for determining the geolocation of subscriber. But some people want more. For example, Maybe a month ago, I found this message on the forum somewhere in Tor. So it was a .onion forum. And actually, this guy is interested in getting the full access over the Sichuan to this communication network. And probably someone even replied to him. So people are constantly looking for getting access to the SS7. Yesterday, actually, I received an email from a guy who wrote to me that he's very interested in this kind of reports because this report already was published. He wrote to me that he was already able to construct some device for collecting data over the radio interface. He's very good in cracking A51, but he's not able at the moment to get the geolocation of mobile subscribers. So he's actually asking me to provide this service to him, and he's actually offering money. But unfortunately, I'm not from a telco operator, and I cannot offer it to him. And the one more way is the most interesting one, is to hack some border device. Because, for example, there are devices called GGSNs. This is the GPRS gateway support node, which is actually used as a proxy server for mobile subscribers to communicate with the internet. Of course, GGSN is not a kind of proxy between internet and the signal network, but this is probably the very good entry point to the mobile operator packet switch network. Because right now, with all that stuff with IP connectivity, you can easily use shorten and search, for example, for port 2123. This is the port for the GPRS tunneling protocol, which is used only across the GRX network, the GRX roaming network. I explained it a bit earlier. So you can look for these ports exposed on the internet. It shouldn't be actually, because there are no communication with the GTP among telco operators over the internet. They use GRX network for this purpose. But still, due to some cruel misconfigurations of some devices, those ports are available on the internet. And GTP is not a very secure protocol as well. Sometimes if you try to use shorten and search for keywords like a GGSN, if you're lucky enough, you can actually find some devices that are exposed with some management protocols right to the internet with SNMP, Telnet, FTP. Come on, what's the purpose of exposing these protocols to the internet? There are no. Sometimes if you are lucky enough, you can actually find the device without no authentication at all. I'm not sure. Maybe this exact device is a kind of honeypot. I guess so. But for sure, there are some devices that are not configured in a secure way. So this is just a cruel misconfiguration and a big problem from the administrative guy, from the network administrative perspective. And this is a very great possibility for an attacker to get entry points to the mobile operator network. Actually, this mostly, right now, this already talk about the insecurities of mobile internet. I would like to speak about it, but I don't think we have enough time for this. But my colleague and me think that the only way to make mobile communication as well as SS7 networks and GPRS more secure is to make the information about its insecurities and vulnerabilities more public. So you can collect all our reports. They're publicly available on our website and our blog. And I guess it is all for me for today. So thank you very much. In case you probably have some questions, you are welcome. Thank you.